my favorite songs. I love that song because it reminds me of where I was at one time, wandering aimlessly and headed for hell. And then Jesus saved me, took me into his harbor, and put me in the haven of rest. And I'm safe forevermore now. The devil couldn't get me if he wanted to. If he tried as hard as he could, he couldn't get me. Not because I'm a good guy, but because Jesus is stronger than he is. Amen. Good singing, Brother Taylor. Now, when are you going to start preaching? I just wondering if God had called you yet. I thought in case he hadn't spoke loud enough, I'd help him out. Joshua chapter number 7. Preaching on the subject tonight on how to be an enemy in your own home. I need that microphone from out. I guess it's laying out in the vestibule, somebody. How to be an enemy in your own home. Joshua chapter number 70. Or 70. Yeah. I think I must have left my glasses somewhere too. Chapter 7. I just like being saved. And I'm glad God called me to preach. I plan on doing it from now on until God tells me to quit. And he hasn't said a word about it yet. So I'm just going to keep on doing it. I figured as long as y'all come, I might as well preach. I came in a little while ago. Everybody just laughing and going on and having a big time. And I told Brother David, I said, boy, these folks seem like they're having way too good of a time, but it'll come to an end. I'm going to the pulpit in a minute. I think we ought to be able to have fun in church, don't you? I really do. In chapter 7, let's begin reading in verse number 1, if you will, please. But the children of Israel committed a trespass. That's a sin. Breaking of God's commandment, his law. Committed a trespass in the accursed thing. Underline the accursed thing. For Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, of the tribe of Judah, took of the accursed thing. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against the children of Israel. And Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is beside Beth-Aven, on the east side of Bethel, and spake unto them, saying, go up and view the country. And the men went up and viewed Ai. And they returned to Joshua and said unto him, let not all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and smite Ai, and make not all the people to labor thither, for they are but few. Now remember, they've just had a great victory at Jericho. God has given them a great victory at Jericho. I mean, God did it all. They didn't have to do anything, really. And so now they're kind of getting a little prideful. And they're saying, look, we don't need to send all the armies up there. Ai is just a little place and compared to Jericho, and we see what happened there. So just send 2,000 or 3,000 up, and we'll wipe them out pretty quick. Verse 4. So there went up thither of the people about 3,000 men, and they fled before the men of Ai. And the men of Ai smote of them 36 men. And they chased them from before the gate, even to Shebarim, and smote them in the going down. Wherefore, the hearts of the people melted and became as water. And Joshua rent his clothes and fell to the earth upon his face before the ark of the Lord until the eventide, and the elders of Israel, and put dust upon their heads. And Joshua said, alas, O Lord God, wherefore hast thou at all brought this people over Jordan to deliver us under the hand of the Amorites to destroy us? Would to God we had been content and dwelt on the other side of Jordan. O Lord, what shall I say when Israel turneth their backs before their enemies? For the Canaanites and all the inhabitants of the land shall hear of it and shall environ us round and cut off our name from the earth. And what wilt thou do unto thy great name? Now, Joshua has stopped here to pray and whine to God about the loss of this battle. And God, being the compassionate God he is, said, get up. Get up. Don't be praying now. You know what to do. Watch this, verse 10. And the Lord said unto Joshua, get thee up. Wherefore liest thou thus upon thy face? Israel hath sinned, and they have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them. For they have even taken of the accursed thing, and have also stolen and dissembled also, and they have put it even among their own stuff. He's talking about what Achan had taken from the city of Jericho in the previous battle that he was not supposed to take. Nobody was supposed to take any of the gold and silver and stuff for themselves, but he did. Verse 12. Therefore the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies, but turned their backs before their enemies because they were accursed. Can I just stop there and just say for a minute that when we are accursed, when we take of the accursed things, when we sin willfully against God, when we in our families decide that we don't care what God says about the way our family ought to be, we're going to do it our way, we bring a curse upon ourselves. And we don't have any room to whine before God and say, well, I can't believe God's let this happen to me. Hey, we brought it on ourselves, didn't we? They did here. He said, neither will I be with you anymore except you destroy the accursed from among you. Up, sanctify the people, and say, sanctify yourselves against tomorrow, for thus saith the Lord God of Israel, there is an accursed thing in the midst of thee, O Israel. Thou canst not stand before thine enemies until you take away the accursed thing from among you. In the morning, therefore, you shall be brought according to your tribes. Underline that phrase, according to your tribes. This is a family deal. And it shall be that the tribe which the Lord taketh shall come according to the families thereof. Underline the word families. And the family which the Lord shall take shall come by households. Underline that word, households. And the household, which he's narrowing it down, isn't he? Getting real specific here to a single household. And the household which the Lord shall take shall come man by man. And it shall be that he that is taken with the accursed thing shall be burnt with fire, and he and all that he hath, because he hath transgressed the covenant of the Lord, and because he hath wrought folly in Israel. So Joshua rose up early in the morning and brought Israel by their tribes, and the tribe of Judah was taken. And he brought the family of Judah, and he took the family of the Zarhites. And he brought the family of the Zarhites man by man, and Zabdi was taken. And he brought his household man by man, and Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, of the tribe of Judah, was taken. And Joshua said unto Achan, my son, give, I pray thee, glory to the Lord God of Israel, and make confession unto him, and tell me now what thou hast done. Hide it not from me. And Achan answered Joshua and said, indeed I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel, and thus have I done. When I saw among the spoils a goodly Babylonish garment, and 200 shekels of silver, and a wedge of gold, 50 shekels weight, then I coveted them and took them. And behold, they are hid in the earth in the midst of my tent, and the silver under it. So Joshua sent messengers, and they ran under the tent, and behold, it was hid in his tent, and the silver under it. And they took them out in the midst of the midst of the tent, and brought them unto Joshua and unto all the children of Israel, and laid them out before the Lord. And Joshua and all of Israel with him took Achan and the son of Zerah, and the silver, and the garment, and the wedge of gold, and his sons and his daughters, and his oxen, and his asses, and his sheep, and his tent, and all that he had. And they brought them unto the valley of Achor. And Joshua said, why hast thou troubled us? The Lord shall trouble thee this day. And all Israel stoned him with stones and burned them with fire. And they had after they had stoned them with stones, and they raised over him a great heap of stones unto this day. So the Lord turned from the fierceness of his anger. Wherefore the name of that place was called the Valley of Achor unto this day. Father, bless us as we look at your precious word. Help us to glean the things from it that can help us in our families tonight. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Once upon a time, a rat looked through a crack in the farmer's house, through the wall, and he saw the farmer's wife opening a package, and as she unwrapped the package, the rat looked closer and closer, trying to see what it was. And as she unwrapped it and opened the box and pulled it out, finally he figured it out, what she had. It was a great big rat trap. Well, the rat immediately ran out to the farmyard, and he began to warn and proclaim. He said, everybody, listen. The farmer's wife has a rat trap. A rat trap. And the hen looked at him and clucked and scratched and said, a rat trap. What is that to me? I hadn't got time to worry about a rat trap, Mr. Rat. And she went about her way. And the rat said, but it's a rat trap. And he looked at the pig, and the pig said, well, Mr. Rat, it is a rat trap, and I'm not very concerned about a rat trap, but I will pray for you. And the rat turned to the cow and said, but cow, it's a rat trap, it's a rat trap. And the cow said, rat trap, a little rat trap, and I'm a big cow. Duh. And so that night, in the darkness of the night, a sound was heard in the house. Snap, sound of the rat trap. The farmer's wife got up and going to see what she had caught in the darkness, didn't bother to light a light, and she reached down to check the rat trap, and it was a venomous snake caught by the tail, and it bit her. And she got sick, and the farmer took her to the hospital immediately, and he tried to treat her and sent her home. And after he got home, everybody knows that the first thing you do, because she had a fever, the first thing you do to treat a fever is you have chicken soup. And so out to the farmyard went the farmer with his hatchet and came back with the ingredients for his chicken soup. Well, she got sicker and sicker and needed people to set up with her all during the day and the night. And so several of the neighbors had come to help with it. And as she was sicker, the more people came, the farmer had to feed them. And so the pig had to be butchered. And finally, the woman died. And then people for miles around came to the funeral and all came to his house. And to feed them all, he had to butcher the cow. Now, when the truth of this scripture is examined, we'll see that the same principle applies. When there's a rat trap, everybody in the farmyard better beware, because it might affect them too. And when a family among us is having problems, it's not just their problem, it's our problem. When Achan went afoul of God and broke the commandment to leave the accursed thing alone, Achan got in trouble, but so did his family, so did his sons, so did his daughter, so did his wife, and so did all of their possessions, and so did all of those people who went up to fight against Ai. They all suffered because of one family's problem. Sometimes we think, and maybe argue, that, well, just because there happens to be a few bad families in the world doesn't mean it affects us. Somebody might say, well, just because there's a family or two in the church that has problems, it doesn't matter to me. And maybe somebody in a particular family might say, well, just because we've got one member in our family that's a problem, for the most part, our family's still okay and everything will be all right. But it wasn't all right for Achan, and it wasn't all right for the children of Israel. One family has problems, and it affects a whole bunch of people. The disintegration of even one family affects all of us. God's heart is broken when one family bites the dust. All of Israel was affected when the children of Israel went up to Ai to fight that battle, and they lost the battle, and they fled. They ran with their tail tucked between their legs because one guy in one family had become the enemy in his family. So that's why I'm preaching on the subject tonight, becoming an enemy in your own family. The word household appears 61 times in the Bible, in the King James. And it's a good word. It covers everybody living in a particular household, in a particular house. And it covers two-parent families, single families, single-parent families. It covers blended families. It covers multicultural families. Everything that lives in the house is part of the family. And consequently, the Bible teaches us that households are important. Now, we want to consider the household of Achan tonight and discover how to be an enemy in your own home, if you want to be. It didn't turn out good for Achan, nor his family. Maybe we could take a warning from it. Three things, three simple things. Number one, neglect your spiritual responsibilities. If you want to be an enemy in your own family, neglect your own spiritual responsibilities. This thing with Achan centers around what? The accursed thing. Look back with me, if you would, one more time. In chapter 7, verse 1, the very first verse we read. But the children of Israel committed a trespass in what? The accursed thing. That's it. The accursed thing. Now, it just happened to be that they mentioned gold and silver and a garment. But the accursed thing could be a lot of different things. But here it's named. The children of Israel committed a sin in taking of the accursed thing. Now, in the previous chapter, if you go back to Joshua chapter 6, verse 17, Joshua chapter 6, verse 17, the previous chapter, it says, before they go into the city of Jericho, to take the city of Jericho under God's direction, it says, and the city shall be accursed, even it and all that are therein to the Lord. Only Rahab the harlot shall live, she and all that are with her in the house. By the way, there we again, we see the household being blessed or cursed because of one person. You remember Rahab the harlot's house? They made it out safe, didn't they? Why? Because of one person, Rahab the harlot, the most immoral woman in town. But she had a heart for God. She surrendered her will to God's will, and her family was saved. And they were not included among the accursed things. And it says, because she hid the messengers that we sent. Verse 18, and ye in any wise keep yourselves, watch this, keep yourselves from the accursed thing, lest ye make yourselves accursed. When ye take of the accursed thing and make the camp of Israel a curse and trouble it. Well, there we go. One person, one enemy in the household can bring the curse upon the whole household, upon the whole church, upon a whole nation. Something. Now, what did Achan do? He took some gold and silver and a garment, but he wasn't supposed to. Do you think God is poor? He was supposed to give that. Everything that was gold and silver was supposed to go into the house of the Lord. Do you think God is poor? Does God need silver and gold? Is he going to be broke because Achan didn't give him that silver and gold? That's not the issue. It's not that God needed that. God blesses on the basis of our obedience or disobedience, and Achan was disobedient. He took that which was God's. We have to be careful taking things that belong to God. That's big business. It doesn't matter how we justify it, doesn't matter how we explain it away or how much we needed it. If it's God's, it's God's. And that was God's stuff that he took. And so we start off, let's think about this. What did he take? Well, first of all, it was material possessions. Hello? It was material possessions that he took. Yes, I do believe that God's people are blessed sometimes and cursed sometimes with the way they deal with their finances and their material possessions. I think, according to Malachi chapter 3, let's turn there and look at it. I think we can clearly see that God's blessings, go to the last book of the Old Testament, Malachi, and look at it with me, chapter 3. Where am I? Yeah, here we go. Chapter 3 and verse number 8. Will a man rob God? Well, that's what we're talking about. In Achan's case, he took something that belonged to God. Am I not right? Somebody agree with me there. He took what belonged to God. He says, will a man rob God? Yet ye have robbed me. But ye say, wherein have we robbed thee? Now, the Israelites and God are having a conversation going back and forth. God said, you've robbed me. They said, where did we rob you, God? He said, well, you've robbed me, and here's how. Wherein have we robbed thee? He said, in tithes and offerings. In tithes and offerings. Well, How could that be? If I work and get my money and I earn my own money, how can God lay claim to that? Because we covered that this morning, didn't we? Everything belongs to God and we're just stewards. And the Bible says the tithe is the Lord's. It belongs to Him. It doesn't belong to me. And it says, verse 9, here's what I wanted to get to. Watch this. Ye are cursed with a curse, for ye have robbed me, even this whole nation. And so when we refuse to give God what belongs to God, we're taking a serious step of bringing a curse upon our family, bringing a curse upon ourselves, and a curse upon our church and perhaps our nation. When my wife got saved 3 years before I did, she was already tithing. And I was lost as a goose, and I didn't have a clue that tithing was anything that should be thought about in my life, because I wasn't even saved. And she didn't take my earnings and tithe off of it against my will, but she did some hair. She's a beautician, and so she did some hair, and she made some money on her own. And you know what she did? She tithed off of her money. She was going to church faithfully, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, and she would take 10% of all of her income, and she would give it through the church as a scriptural in the New Testament, and she tithed. And I think because of that, God blessed our home. Even though I was lost, God had mercy and was gracious toward us. And I think because she was praying and had other people praying for my salvation, I believe because she was faithful and did not take of the accursed thing, she gave God what was God's, and then God honored her prayers and saved my old wicked soul. And how can I do less than I myself than to pick up her habit of obeying God and tithing? I've been doing it for 30 some odd years, and friend, I hadn't lost any weight from loss of meals. Haven't been in the poorhouse yet. And somehow, there's been times when I wondered, but somehow God's always pulled me out. You say, but that's Old Testament, and I really don't think it's New Testament to tithe. Do you think under grace in the New Testament we ought to do less than those people did in the Old Testament? Tithe is just kind of kindergarten stuff. You say, but man, I can't imagine giving 10% of what I make to the Lord. Well, you got to first realize it's not yours, it's God's. If I owe Brother Patrick $100 and he comes by and he says, hey, Pastor, have you been able to accumulate enough to pay me my $100 yet? How do you think he'd look at me if I said, well, yeah, I've got $100, but man, I can't afford to give you $100. Yeah, but you borrowed it from me. Yeah, but that's a lot of money, man. I can't just fork over $100 to you. What do you think he'd think about me? I think he'd probably think, that's my $100. You know what I think God thinks? If I make $100, I think God thinks, 10 of that's mine, buddy. Well, actually, all of it's mine, but I just asked you to give me 10 of it. Well, I'm not going to make the blessings of God accursed on my life and take a chance like that. Man, I don't want to cut off my nose to spite my face. I'm going to love and give to the one who is the provider of all my blessings. Hello? It gets kind of quiet at times like this. Well, okay. Hallelujah. I have a good time when people squirm, though, you know? What else? That was material things. But what else? What else did Achan, what else did he do that day when he took that stuff, it was the accursed thing, he took more than material stuff. You know what he did? He thieved the will of God. God's will was for him to give that to the house of the Lord, to follow God's will. And you know what he said? He said, I don't care about your will, God. I'm going to do my will. And he stole the will of God. He took the accursed thing. Not only did he take material possessions, but he took the will that God expected him to show obedience, and he stole that will and was self-willed instead. His personal will. If you want to be an enemy in your own home, just have a personal will that will not bend for anything. Hello? A personal will that says, I'm going to do as I please, and I don't care about the rules at home. I don't care about what happens to anybody else in the home. I don't care who else might get caught in the rat trap. Doesn't affect me. It might. Personal will. He did as his flesh led him instead of surrendering to the known will of God. Has God shown you something that you should not change? Has he shown you his will and you have said, well, I know that seems to be the will of God, but I just don't want to do that? Well, when we steal the will of God, it's every bit as bad as stealing the monetary and the physical and material blessings. It's the same thing. Proverbs 3:6 says, in all thy ways acknowledge him. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. You know what happens when we go against the will of God? God has led us to do something. God has shown us the light. He wants us to go in a certain direction, do a certain thing, either to acquire something, to do something, or to give up something, and we say, no, I'll not do it. I'm going to do my will. Then what we've just done is just turned off the light to the path of success and pleasing God. He said, in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. But when we refuse to do the will of God, we turn off the light to the pathway, and we're headed for trouble. We become thieves of God's will and replace it with our own. What else did he take? Well, what about time? Achan, think about this. When those people invaded Jericho, God told them what to be doing. And the time that Achan was planning that theft, and the time that he was sneaking around to get it, and the time that he took it, and the time that he went and secured it and hid it, all of that time he was spending, he was doing stuff that was against God's will, and he was doing what he wanted to do. He was wasting the God-given gift of time. Time. Time is not ours. Time is given by God. We all have a certain number of years, days, and seconds to live. And when we go against God and steal his time, we're shooting ourselves in the foot. It's only time that he's made us stewards over. Does that make sense? We're a steward over our material possessions, and we're a steward over the time that God has given us. And he was using his time for something other than God. People tend to compartmentalize their time into sacred and secular. Now, listen to this. Sometimes a lot of people go to church on Sunday. Watch this now. People go to church on Sunday, and they say, I've put in my time at church. Monday is mine. Tuesday is mine. Wednesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday, mine. I'll give Sunday to the Lord, but the rest of the time is mine. I don't know where we ever got that idea, but all of the time belongs to God. And we're just stewards over it. And what we do on Monday through Saturday matters just as much as what we do on Sunday. Time. Kind of like... Reminds me of the wife who was coming down the stairs, and she saw her husband laying on the couch. She said, what are you doing? He said, well, I've been killing flies. I've killed 5 already, 3 females and 1 male, or 2 male, or 2, 3 females and 2 males. And she said, well, how did you come to that conclusion? He said, 3 of them were sitting on the telephone and 2 were on the TV remote. How much time do we give to God doing spiritual things? Well, so Achan became an enemy in his own family and in his own nation. Number 2, the second way he became an enemy was sinful secrets in the home. Did you get that? Sinful secrets in the home. Sinful secrets in the home. He was his own worst enemy because he had something hid that nobody else knew about that was a sin. Now, right now, God might run some things through our mind. Secret sins hidden in the home. Joshua 7:21. Let's read that verse one more time. When I saw among the spoils a goodly Babylonish garment, and 200 shekels of silver, and a wedge of gold and of 50 shekels weight, I coveted them and took them, and behold, they are what? Hid in the earth in the midst of my tent and the silver under it. There are things that we tend to hide. Some people more than others. But it's a temptation that can come to all of us. Hiding sinful things in our homes. And yet Numbers 32:23 says, and be sure your sin will find you out. We think because we hide something under the floor of the tent that God's not going to see it. I guess that's what we think, but he sees it. Somehow we get the idea if we can hide it from the husband or from the wife, or hide it from the parents, or hide it from the preacher, hide it from the youth director, hide it from somebody, hide it from the boss. Somehow if we hide it from those people, it'll never be found out. But God, the Bible says that his eyes run to and fro through the earth. He sees everything. And it's not that God's a big bully sitting up there in heaven just waiting for us to make a mistake so he can conk us on the head with a club. But our blessings depend upon our obedience and being open and honest. What is it that might be hidden in our tent? Number three, how else did Achan become an enemy in his own home? He failed to give God the glory in the home. Joshua said in verse 19 of our text, chapter 7, and Joshua said unto Achan, my son, give, I pray thee, glory to the Lord God of Israel, and make confession unto him. Tell me now what thou hast done, and hide it not from me. The time to give glory to God is before the judgment falls. I've done some study on the word glory recently, and it is amazing to me that most of the time when God's glory is mentioned, almost every time you'll find judgment right there with it. I'd never noticed that before. Have you ever noticed that? The word glory, you just look it up. You do a search with your Strong's Concordance or on your computer software, and you look up God's glory, and you'll find that more times than not, when God's glory is mentioned, there's going to be judgment there with it. I mean, today's culture thinks the glory of God is whoop-dee-doo. Everything's happy and glorious, and we're all just having a good time, and we ought to have a good time. But you can't have a good time for real when you're hiding things from God and when you're being an enemy in your own home and you fail to give him glory ahead of time. You just can't do it. Glory is connected with judgment. We can become our own enemy when we fail to give glory to God. How can we give glory to God before the judgment falls? Well, I wonder if our homes would be giving glory to God more that if our homes were a place of prayer. Huh? I wonder if God's glory would shine about to those who come into our home and those who live in our home if there were Bibles lying about in the home. And sometimes those Bibles are open. I wonder if God wouldn't, I wonder if his glory would not shine in our homes, if in our homes, instead of it sounding like a nightclub, if the music sounded sweet and melodious and godly music. I wonder if that wouldn't reflect God's glory. I wonder if God's glory might shine more in our home instead of having magazines emphasizing romance and sex and nudity. I wonder if our magazines and reading material, if it was godly reading material, even if it's fiction or whatever, if it was godly, I wonder if God's glory might not shine a little more in our homes. I wonder about our actions in the home. I wonder if God's glory might not shine more in our homes if our interactions with each other in the home was gracious. You know, some of the meanest spirited talk that ever takes place happens in people's homes. I'm talking about Christians. People who speak in a snappy, sarcastic, impatient, mean, nasty way. Does that reflect God's glory? If God's glory is going to shine in our homes, then the atmosphere needs to be one of graciousness. How gracious are we in our home? I've knocked on doors of homes before. Well, just where I knocked, I don't know how many times it's happened. Go up to somebody's door and reach up, I was going to knock, and all of a sudden there's, "What are you doing in there? Hey, get out of there. Oh, don't tell me what to do." And then they're going to each other and they're yelling and screaming and cussing. And I'm not sure whether to walk away or go ahead and make the visit, you know. And so I wait, thinking maybe it'll quiet down a little bit. And so finally I knock, and somebody comes to the door smiling. Says, "Oh, hi, Pastor. How are you? So glad to see you." "Yeah, I bet you are." What about respect? I wonder if the glory of God might shine more in our homes if there's respect. Respect. Kids, let me ask you something. Do you ever get too old to show respect to your parents? Never. I can't always say I had the best attitude towards my parents. There were times when I was rebellious. I know that surprises you. I was a stinker when I was a teenager and in my 20s. But I might not have always had the best attitude and probably needed a good licking for what was going on in here. But I always tried to respect my parents. My daddy was my daddy. He was not a churchgoer, but I respected him. I showed honor to my dad. I would never think about cussing my dad. I would never think about yelling at him. Neither my mom. The times that I had a bad attitude and I looked in my mom's eyes and saw her eyes with that hurt in her eyes, that was like 1,000 daggers sticking in my heart. Respect. You never get too old, and you never get too important. There's been some mighty important people who have learned the lesson that to become successful in life, you need to show proper respect to everybody. And sweetness. Oh, how the glory of God could shine in our homes if there's just a spirit of sweetness. When I visited my grandma and grandpa Mankin over in Lunenburg, little community where nobody knows is, I go to visit them in that little old house they had. Their whole house, you could have put the whole thing in this little auditorium here. Oh, it wasn't this big. And when I go to their house out there in Lunenburg, little old community where nothing seemed like nobody but old people lived there. And my grandma, y'all know, they used to live up there. My grandma and Grandpa Mankin, when I'd go there, there was something about their house that just felt like the Lord lived there. When I went in there, it was kind of like entering the Holy of Holies. It was like the presence of the Lord was in that place. They were both saved, and there was an atmosphere of sweetness. There was a softness in their voice. There was a twinkle in their eye. And there was no yelling, screaming. Now, they may have done it at some time. I just never heard it. If it was an act, they did a pretty good job of it when I was there. And they talked about the Lord. They talked about the Lord. I remember going when my grandpa died, and they still had wakes back in those days, and I think I might have been maybe 8 or 9 years old. I don't remember now. Grandpa died, and they had his casket in the little bedroom. You walk in from the front porch into the little living room, and then there's a bedroom immediately to the right, and they had Grandpa's casket in there. And I remember Grandma took me and And when I came in, she came immediately to me, and she had this just this sweet, peaceful look on her face. Now, this is her husband of like 60 years or longer, and he's passed away. But instead of crying and boo-hooing, she came and put her arm around me, and she had this sweet look on her face, and her eyes twinkled. And she said, "Do you want to go in and see Grandpa?" And I'm thinking, "No, I don't." But I didn't say that. I knew she wanted me to. And she put her arm around me and walked me through the door. And when we got in there, she turned me and pointed me towards the casket. And I guess the tears started to well up in my eyes. And she patted me on the shoulder and hugged me up close to her. She said, "Now, Ricky, you have to remember that Papa's not dead. He's with Jesus tonight. He's with Jesus. He's in heaven with the Lord. And he's happy now. And you must be happy too. And I'm happy." And it was just such a glorious time that I remember that sweetness in their home. I'll never forget it. Do we have that kind of sweetness in our home? Is our home a place where there's cursing and yelling and bitterness? Or is it a place of sweetness and talk of the Lord? I visited in some homes where I've seen things hanging on the wall, demonic looking things that look like demons and skulls and crossbones and rock and rap pictures of rock and rap singers and their vulgar attire and their just the ungodly look. And I thought, no wonder our families are disintegrating into places where there's no love of God anymore. I would to God that our walls could house maybe some scriptures or some kind of symbols of Christianity rather than symbols of wickedness and ungodliness. I'm not talking about idols and stuff like that. I'm just talking about something to remind us of the Lord. Well, the sweet Christian influences of a godly home is so refreshing to those who love the Lord. And those changes can be made. You know why I preach? I mean, besides the fact that God called me, I preach to see change. And if your home is not a place of sweetness, a place of graciousness, a place where the Lord seems to live, I want to challenge you to start tonight to make your home such. When we heard Brother David Gibbs preach, the Christian lawyer, a couple of nights ago in Little Rock, one of the points was, you got to stop griping. You got to stop griping. You know what? We need to make this church an NGZ. Not a DMZ, but a NGZ. No gripe zone. You know what you need to make your home? An NGZ. A no gripe zone. Make it a place of sweetness, and that alone. When Achan's sin was dealt with, and the children of Israel got things right with God, in the next chapter, chapter 8, they go up to Ai, and this time they win the battle because they got everything settled and got everything right with God. Too bad that a household had to face destruction because of it. Our households could turn around right now and not see destruction. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you'd bless in a wonderful way in our homes. Lord, our homes ought to be the kind of place where you feel welcome, a place where our children feel safe and secure and blessed, a place where parents want to go and find as a refuge from the world, a place of sweetness, a place of graciousness. Lord, help our homes to be free of the enemy. Bless the invitation, we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Would you stand, please? Invitation's open as the piano plays if you need to pray. Just help yourself. Help yourself.